the regular notice requirement of the New Jersey Open Public Meeting Act has been complied with and that adequate advance notice of this meeting was given at least 48 hours in advance. On December the 10th, 2015, notice was mailed to the Aldea and Courier Post. Notice was also posted on the bulletin board located by the reception desk at the central office and all school building bulletin boards within the district. Can we, oh my agenda. Wait a minute, where is that? Okay, right here. Can we do a roll call, Ms. Regina?
Ms. Teresa Atwood?
Present.
Mr. Jose Brito Bueno? Ms. Dorothy Burley?
Present.
Mr. Joshua Cole?
Present.
Ms. Taisha Manier? Mr. Minister Wasim Muhammad?
Present.
Mrs. Felicia Reyes Morton? Mrs. Martha Wilson?
Present.
Ms. Catherine Blackshear?
Here. Can we salute the flag? I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all. Thank you. Before we start tonight's board meeting, I want to take a moment to address all of you this evening. We are coming up on the end of the 2015 calendar year, and the flipping of the calendar always makes me think back on all that happened this year and the many, many people and things that made it special, good, bad, and in between. I thought that in recognition of the end of the year that we would join, that you would join us in reflection and gratitude, because we know that everything we do is in service of our students and the schools we're maintaining for them to have a quality education every day. So instead of going into closed session, we are inviting all of you and your families to join us in the Creative Arts Gym tonight for an end of the year meal. Please enjoy and then rejoin us here in the public school board meeting. Thank you.
And the board will reconvene its public meeting in this room at 6:45 p.m.
Thank you. We're going to go to the gym.
To the gym.
All right. Just want to welcome everyone back. Hope you all enjoyed that meal. I want to thank Ms. Blackshear, who first suggested to do that, and really enjoyed breaking bread with everyone. So before I jump into my presentation, we want to formally kick things back off here at the board, but also we're going to do a student board induction. Brian, do we need to do a quick roll call before that?
No.
Okay.
State of New Jersey.
And that I will bear
true faith
and allegiance
to the same
and to the governments
established in
the United States
and this state
under the authority
of the people.
State your full name again.
Dejiana Harris.
I solemnly affirm
that I possess
the qualifications
prescribed by
the Camden City School District
for the office of
student board member
and that I will faithfully
impartially
and justly perform
all of the duties
of that office
according to the best of my ability. Congratulations.
Thank you.
So yeah, we don't have to because we haven't went into exact session. Okay. All All right, so I'm going to come down and give our presentation, and I assume, as always, the board members will go and sit down in the first row. All right, good evening, everyone. So we're going to give you all a few updates, one on Camden enrollment, second on our Camden Commitment Progress Report. It's been 3 months since we released the latest version of the Camden Commitment. So as always, I want to give you all a quarterly update as far as the progress we're making. Then we're going to share with you all our CUSAC results, our 2014-15 CUSAC results. We'll walk you through those outcomes and give you a quick update on where we are with PARC, and then we'll close out, as we always do, with some district highlights. I think a lot of you all know, on November the 10th, we announced Camden enrollment, which is an optional enrollment system that is intended to streamline the process for families. And to date, there are 17 different applications with 8 different monthly deadlines. So we're just trying to bring everything into one application and make families and students' lives easier. So again, I want to highlight that it's optional in that if you are pleased with the school that your child is attending, you don't need to participate in the process. If you are looking for a new school, and for example, if you're in eighth grade looking for a high school, this process will make all students' and parents' lives a lot easier. And I'm also pleased to announce today that all schools, all charter schools, district and Renaissance schools, will be participating in the process. So here's some additional information. We have a website, camdenenrollment.org. We also have a hotline dedicated to all enrollment questions. You can see the number there that's noted. And we've also set up 3 enrollment centers, knowing that it's important to put these in geographically diverse parts of the city so that families can better access these enrollment centers to the extent they have questions about the process, they're looking for a student guidebook. Also, we're going to be holding a citywide fair on January 30th at the BB&T Pavilion. Again, that'll be on January the 30th. And so this will be a free event for all Camden families. And from now until January the 5th, which is when the enrollment window will begin, we will be doing a lot, just trying to get the word out, ensure that all families know what the process entails. So again, that application window opens on January the 5th, and it will close March the 1st. So in that spirit, we had an enrollment launch party on November the 19th. We had over 40 parents attend this launch party. It was a big success. And again, it's important to note that the enrollment, the Camden enrollment is completely voluntary. We look forward to sharing all information to the extent families are going to participate. So moving on to the Camden Commitment Progress Report. First promise, safe students, safe schools. The biggest update here is that we have released our new students' rights and responsibilities. So this is a guide in terms of what used to be called the Student Code of Conduct. And the focus here, as we've discussed, is on reducing suspensions and increasing learning time. And so that's accomplished by creating alternatives to out-of-school suspension in the form of restoration rooms and service projects. And in a couple of schools which I want to highlight, have built-in in-school suspension, which wasn't the case in prior years. So at Hatch and Woodrow Wilson, they do have an in-school suspension policy there. They still have out-of-school suspension, but they have implemented in-school suspension at both Hatch and Woodrow Wilson. And to the extent anyone wants to talk about that in more detail, certainly be happy to take that offline. Our second promise, as it relates to technology and higher quality facilities. So we have now resolved more than 2,700 tech-related cases since September. And our average response time we've been able to cut in half, so more than 50% reduction in our response time. We are always working to improve our response time, and we take these matters very, very seriously, and we will continue to solicit input on how we can improve the process. And just a quick update on the School Development Authority's work on Camden High School. The School Development Authority has hired a design architect for the Camden High renovation project. And in January, as I believe I noted in the last board meeting, we're going to kick off a series of public meetings to talk about community input as far as what the renovations will look like. So really excited to be able to take that conversation to current families, to alumni, any and all concerned citizens, residents that want to weigh in on the renovations at Camden High. Our third promise, as far as excellent schools and high-quality instruction. So we're supporting teachers. This is a continuous effort with weekly individual coaching, weekly group coaching, which is now twice as long, thanks to our new teachers contract, and a new lecture series on improving instruction. We had a family literacy night that was hosted on December the 3rd to give families an opportunity to learn about strategies to support their students in literacy. And again, in the spirit of continued efforts, we're working with our principals in weekly individual coaching sessions and biweekly group sessions. We just had one earlier today. We also have a new webinar series. We've also launched a pilot on trauma-informed care, which speaks to some of the challenges with chronic absenteeism and working with some of our most chronically absent students by going directly to their homes to holistically address some of the challenges that they're grappling with. Clearly, the impact of poverty on the family structure is a real challenge that we face here in Camden. And so for our most chronically absent students, we have taken this holistic approach to just get to know our students and families' lives better and see how we can support them in an array of ways as far as housing and special education services and, you know, whatever other issue may be the case for that student. Our fourth promise as it relates to family engagement. So I already walked you through the latest updates on Camden enrollment, which is one of the big initiatives and goals under our fourth promise. We've also launched a text message service to help keep families informed, and so far more than 1,100 families have signed up. I'll share with you some additional information on that in a moment. And thirdly, I'm pleased to say that we recently won a $250,000 state grant to expand family programming and build stronger family and school partnerships. So that was just recently announced from the state, and pleased to kind of walk through families in more detail in the coming weeks about what that entails. So big kudos to the Family and Community Engagement team for leading that effort and winning that grant. Promise five, with central office effectiveness, ensuring that we're prioritizing resources at the school level. That's a continued effort on our part, and will certainly take place as we budget for the 16-17 school year. We've also talked about how we want to prioritize local vendors. So partnering with local small businesses to provide audio services at our board meetings is an example of that, and also for providing food at community meetings. And this evening's dinner is another example of that. Newtown Restaurant, which is a locally owned restaurant. Woodrow Wilson alumnus, who's the owner of the restaurant, and they've been a good partner of ours, and that's the reason we had them cater for this evening. And just where at all possible through our procurement process here, with the vendors that we choose, we try to give preference to local vendors at all turns. All right, moving on to CUSAC. So for those of you that aren't familiar with the intricacies of CUSAC, at a high level, there are two parts to it. There's an annual process that is called the SOA, the Statement of Assurance, and then there's a more involved process that occurs every 3 years. That is the DPR, the District Performance Review. And those two scores ultimately feed into one score. And so there are five key areas that CUSAC evaluates: fiscal management, governance, instruction and program, operations, personnel. And so I'm gonna walk you through the scores in a moment. We're also joined this evening by Lavelle Pugh Bassett, who is the county executive superintendent, who led this process, and she'll share a few words as well. And so here's where we landed on the far right with the 2014 and 15 CUSAC review. So I want to share with you all a few headlines. On the to the left of these final outcomes here is the district self-evaluation. So every district in New Jersey first evaluates itself across these five categories, and that then leads to the state and county administrators to come in and verify those scores. And so what you'll see is pretty strong alignment in terms of our district self-assessment and the ultimate outcomes. And that's really, really important when you think about if we want to overcome the challenges that we've been grappling with as a district over the past several decades, we first need to be clear-eyed about what those challenges actually are. And so our assessment shows that we were honest in our self-assessment, As you can see, the ultimate scores on the right more or less match the scores on the left. In fact, in governance, we ended up doubling our score because from the time this self-assessment happened, we updated our policy manual, which added significantly to the overall score. There was a slight discrepancy in operations because our HIB process was slightly off the timeline that was expected from a compliance standpoint, so we lost 5 points there, but everything else stayed consistent. And the other big headline being that we went up significantly in governance because of our updated policy manual. To the left of those scores for the 2014-15 QSAC review, you'll see the previous DPR, so that was 3 years ago. And as you'll note there, the self-evaluation was pretty far off from the ultimate evaluation from the state. So with personnel being an example there, 100% self-assessment, and then it being 19% with the state assessment. So we avoided that discrepancy. We were honest about our self-evaluation. And then the final headline, which I'll share before I ask Ms. Pubasa to join, is that we are seeing progress. And governance is a key example there. We are seeing progress. We are not where we want to be. We expect these scores to continue to increase. And ultimately, that will lead to local control. And I've been open and honest with you all about that. We don't expect a 20-year state intervention here in Camden. I do believe that sooner than later, local control will be a reality here. But we've got some more work to do to continue to stabilize the school district. But the big news being, again, honest self-assessment, and we're seeing steady progress, particularly as it relates to governance. And I'll give you one more example here in a moment. Actually, I'm gonna jump to this next slide. So these are some of the highlights from our current scores on in the middle column here. And then we have some growth areas, meaning these are the areas we need to address going forward. And I view this as an opportunity. So just take, for example, instruction and program. So we rolled out a new math and literacy curriculum K-12. That in and of itself doesn't give us additional points in the QSAC process. We have to have comprehensive social studies science on top of the math and literacy. We are well on our way to implementing a new science and social studies curriculum as well. In fact, we're working with county officials to implement that. So again, this process ended in June. We've continued to make more progress, and soon enough, those points will come in. So steadily making progress, and again, I view this as an opportunity for us going forward. Ms. Pubasa, is there anything you'd like to add?
I want to reiterate the importance of the match between the district self-assessment and the county verification, because that's significantly important for us, because we go into districts and oftentimes they see themselves in a completely different way than the department does when we come in. And I just need to say that the scores that were generated in the verification process were generated by significant review of documentation, by interviews with administration staff, teachers. We had like extensive conversations about very, very targeted areas. So it wasn't just a peripheral assignment of points. We actually did some deep ditch diving into some of your documentation. So that in and of itself was significant. The other thing I wanted to mention is that for QSAC, the points or the assignment of points to each of the sections and the indicators are all or nothing in many areas. And I think that you alluded to the fact that for the science and social studies curriculum, even though you may have had something in those specific areas, you would need all 9 completed in order to get the points for that section. So you need to know, even though you only see the numbers that are the total scores, you need to also know that there might be some missed indicators or missed points that were based upon not having completed the process. That doesn't mean that the process didn't start, that just means that it was not completed by the time we came in to verify the scores. So if the district was undertaking an area that they knew and identified during the self-assessment was an issue, but had not completed that, we were not able to assign points to that area. So what you see may be a missed indicator from the naked eye, but if you dig deeper, you might actually see that there were some things that had already been started. And the final thing that I wanted to comment about regarding what happens after this, right? So the district has availed themselves to many resources, has availed themselves to many opportunities for best practices. The district has reached out to the department for help in those very, very targeted areas which they've missed. So So that's really important because we've had some really good conversations about where to go from here in certain areas. So the district has really started doing the work of correcting some of the numbers that you've seen. The other issue is that there be a corrective action plan that will be formally submitted to the department, at which point we will review and make sure that the corrective action activities are aligned with the areas in which they missed. And so that goes through another process of approval, and at that point, we will come back out in 6 months to see where the district stands. So this is only the beginning of the process, but the importance of knowing and understanding that the district actually did a fair assessment of themselves, and you can see based upon those side-by-side numbers that the department's verification was very, very close to what the district has seen of themselves is significant in creating a foundation for moving forward and to being able to create an honest look at the district's needs and the district's issues. So I want to make sure that I emphasize that because there are many, many districts that see themselves in a completely different way than the department will see them. And knowing and understanding that and understanding that those CUSAC numbers are not necessarily all or nothing in the sense that the district is not doing anything or the district actually did it. There are some in between that you don't see, but that in between doesn't get assigned any points. Okay, so I just wanted to make sure I kind of gave that background because I think that if you picked up the piece of paper and only saw an 11, you don't see the work that's being done in very specific areas. And the district has really, really opened up the lines of communication to avail themselves to resources to be able to work on those targeted areas.
Thank you for joining us this evening. Certainly appreciate it. Her name is Lavelle Pugh-Bassett. She's the county executive superintendent. So she's with the county, which is an arm of the state, and she has been leading CUSAC processes in South Jersey and across the state for a long time now. CUSAC is an involved, complicated process, and to the extent anyone would like to set up a meeting with our staff to go through these results in more detail, we would certainly be happy to do that. Feel free to grab us at the end of this meeting and be more than happy to set up that conversation. All right, so really quickly on park results. Our park results will be released Thursday. We wanted to wait and first share them with principals and staff before we share them out with families. So I met earlier today with our principals alongside our deputy superintendent and her team to share school by school outcomes. And Thursday, some of you all may know, is a teacher PD day. And so all of our school leaders will share out their school-based results with their staff. Now the target is that Thursday and Friday, the park score reports will go home with students. Some schools may wait and hold a family meeting. Depends on what the principal wants to do. So again, some will send the park score reports for every single student home with the student. Other schools may wait and hold a family meeting to share them out with students and family because they may want a more intimate setting where everyone is in one room together. So I will say this, in terms of the overall district outcomes, we will put those on our website by Friday of this week. So if anyone is looking for those data points, I know a number of you all, looking at you, Ms. Jocelyn, and others who have been asking, we will have that on the website so we don't have to wait for every last student to have received their report card. But we did feel it was important to first share the news with principals and staff before we put the data out in a bigger way. At the January board meeting, I will be reviewing them as part of my superintendent presentation in more detail. All right, so a few district highlights. Hopefully some of you all saw the Camden High Marching Band on Good Morning Philadelphia on Fox 29, so that was great to see. I want to recognize some Brim alumna who have been supporting their school. So I don't know if any of you all know the Colosso twins. They are alums, class of 2007 from Brim, and they're now at Cooper Medical School, and they have a partnership with Brim where they're basically mentoring and supporting those students who have a passion for the sciences. So I mentioned the text messaging program as part of our Camden Commitment Progress Report update. This is how you can sign up. If you text yes to this number, 684-53, you can be on the distribution list, and it's just a good way to keep in touch. And you can also go to this website to match your number to your child's school. So separate matching for each individual school. And so this is just our effort to make sure as much information is going from the school level down to families. And I should have mentioned this earlier, this is also part of a broader effort in terms of making sure we're promoting the best within our existing district schools. So as part of this whole Camden enrollment, we're building videos that highlight our school's extracurricular activities and their successes. And so stay tuned for that as well, as I know a lot of the students and staff are really excited in developing those videos. I want to just congratulate the Panthers and the Tigers for a great 2015 season. Panthers fell just short in the state championship game. Tigers had a tremendous season, huge turnaround from the year before. So huge thanks to all the coaches who dedicate countless hours and certainly to all the students. I don't know how many of you all went to the Harvest Festival at Sharp, but it was a huge success. I know a number of our staff members went. So just thank you to everyone who participated and volunteered. I heard it was a really, really great turnout. I mentioned Family Literacy Night. This is at Dudley School here. So just wanted to share those pictures with you all. Heard nothing but good things there. We had a district-wide food bank, food drive led by the Food Bank of South Jersey. So in total, the district donated 4,200 pounds of food to help feed local families through the holiday season. And a special shout out to ECDC. They led the way, contributing 800 pounds from ECDC alone. Where's Ms. Parker? I'm sure she had something to do with that. Congratulations. Yorkship held a nice Thanksgiving community meal. I want to give that school a lot of credit, especially with Principal Reed Thompson leading the way in terms of community engagement. I always see events happening there, and this is certainly emblematic of their overall efforts in trying to build inroads in their local community. And we will recognize those who are retiring up on stage. Thank you all very much. All right, I'm going to turn it over to Ms. Wilson, who's going to read off the retirees.
Good evening, everyone. I would first like to say congratulations to all of our retirees and the time that you have served in our district. The first one is Rafael Larasante, Custodian E, Mechanic, Warehouse, Patricia Peoples, Clerk 3, Molina Elementary School, Daisy Ramos, Teacher of Special Education, Dudley Family School, Barbara Sullivan, Social Worker, Camden High School, The Goodwill, Linda Wiley, Professional A at Dudley Family School, and Marion Wise, Guidance Counselor for Davis Elementary School. We'd like to say thank you for each and every one of you for participating in the Camden City School District for our children for all those numbers of years. Thank you.
Thank you.
My mistake. Raphael served 15 years and 9 months. Patricia Peoples, 25 years and 1 month. Daisy Ramos, 21 years, 7 months. Barbara Sullivan, 26 years, 1 month. Linda Wiley, 34 years, 6 months. And Marion Wise, 23 years, 4 months. Thank you again for your service. It's a lot of education.
Thank you, Ms. Wilson. I want to now just invite board members, to the extent you have any questions on my presentation and specifically on CUSAC. I know Ms. P. Bassett is sticking around for a few more minutes, to the extent you have questions for us that we can help answer. Okay, I know we've had a few opportunities to discuss CUSAC, so I will now turn the meeting over to Regina Robinson, our business administrator, to present the business office agenda items.
The board secretary presents the following business office items for approval, 1 through 13, respectfully to the superintendent for approval.
you want to clarify that one matter? Okay. In accordance with the powers vested in me under Title 18A, I hereby approve today's superintendent's agenda items and business office agenda items. So I will now see if there are any questions and comments from our student board members. So I don't know if you all want to start left or right, or looks like camera is grabbing the microphone, so we'll start with camera.
Hello, everyone. I want to welcome everybody to Creative Arts today. Thank you for coming.
Thank you for hosting.
And I just want to thank everyone for helping us with our Creative Arts promotion video that we did for the Camden enrollment. And I want to thank everyone for letting us, a few students from Creative Arts, do the Camden enrollment commercial for Channel 19. We really enjoyed
it. Camera saying the jingle for the commercial.
I also want to tell everyone that we have had a few admission counselors come from Caldwell, and we're about to have one from Bloomfield to do on-site admission at our school. And around 20 seniors have been accepted to Caldwell University.
That's great.
I also want to share that our Christmas show on December 10th was a success, and we're showing it again this Thursday.
Okay. Yeah. What time?
Around 6.
Okay. Thanks.
No problem. One concern I do have is the curriculum. I remember junior year I took algebra, and this year I'm taking AP calculus, so it's like a big gap between algebra 2 to AP calculus. So it's just, I just want to know, can the juniors be prepared to take AP calculus with a trig or a pre-calc class? Mm-hmm. And we are still in need of ink for our school. Thank you.
Thanks, Cameron.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
My name is Antoine Morrison. I'm the representative from Camden High School. I just want to reiterate what the superintendent presented about the Camden High ban on Fox 29 News. That was putting Camden on the map. It's getting Camden High band some recognition. And the football team made it to state first time since 2005. That's all I have to share.
Thanks, Antoine.
Hi, I'm Kiana Grady. I'm the student representative for Brim Medical Arts High School. So I didn't really have any shout outs I wanted to give at the moment, but for my concern was mainly just getting new computers for my school since they're very old and they're outdated and we're not able to complete projects and such since the programs are old, and we need also supplies such as like ink and paper for the printers. But that's it. Thank you.
Good evening, everyone.
Good evening.
My name is Dania Crisden, and I'm the rep from Eddie's High School. I first want to thank the Board of Education for updating our library and giving us new laptops, computers, iPads for us to use the media center whenever we need it, because before we didn't have that opportunity, and now it's great that we all get to go and use the technology more than we ever did before. I also want to shout out the school-based youth services programs at each and every school, because the person that's at my school, her name is Ayana Dickerson. She is such a big help to me, and she does more than a regular school-based youth service person does. She's actually our LTI coordinator at our school as well. So she helps us with our resumes, cover letters, but she also, on Tuesday nights, takes me to a girls group where I get to go and have counseling sessions basically with her and a group of girls who went to Creative Arts, and that's like a good opportunity we get to do with her. It's more than just about being at your job and just working in the school. She goes out of her way to help the girls that she does, that she works with during school and the whole school as well. The only concern that I have really doesn't have a lot to do with Mr. Paymont, but I just want to stress the importance that our school is still a school. a lot of our athletes are thinking about leaving our school, and a lot of athletes who want to pursue athletics in college are thinking about not going to MedEast because we're not recognized as a school. At the moment, we aren't recognized as a school. I just want to stress the importance that MedEast is a school, and we are gradually getting better and better, and that our academics are going over through the roof. So I think that your decision on what school you go to should never be because of athletics, but academics and what school will take you higher.
Yeah, so let me actually jump in on this one. The NCAA, for reasons unbeknownst to us, is not recognizing MedEast as a high school. And we're working with them. Ashley has worked tirelessly. I mean, there's a formal letter from us saying MedEast is a school and should be recognized. And this is a really unfortunate situation where one of our student athletes who graduated last year is basically going to have to take a redshirt year because he's ineligible because the NCAA doesn't recognize MedEast as a school. It is absolutely ridiculous. It is a bureaucratic hoop we have to jump through, and it doesn't make any sense why it hasn't been resolved yet. Clearly, anyone with eyes can read a letter that says MedEast is a school or could come visit the school and see that it's a school. So if anyone has any ties into the NCAA, has any connections, any ability to help us move the needle on this, we would welcome any help we can find. I have heard from others that the NCAA is notoriously hard to work with when it comes to these things, and they are a large bureaucracy where things don't move as fast as they should. So I'm really sorry that MedEast has to deal with this, and Denise has been really, really helpful in terms of being an advocate and pushing everyone to move even faster.
Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Beatrice. I am the rep for Woodrow Wilson, and I just want to put out there that we, the students, are still waiting for our library. Everyone is saying that we have a library, but we don't have not a librarian. We don't have the equipment to call it a library. I want to give a shout out to Ms. Pruitt. She's an excellent college counselor, but there is a lot of seniors. They need to do their SATs. We don't even have ink for them to print it out. And I've been expressing this since our first meeting, so I really will ask y'all if you can please. We need more technology, and we need ink, and we need all the help that you guys can send us. Thank you.
So I want to thank all of you all for raising these pressing issues, and please know that we are in the process of addressing every last one of them, especially as it relates to resource challenges. I mean, you heard with MedEast, we were able to upgrade a lot of their equipment. These things can sometimes take a little bit of time with procurement processes, but first we try to internally triage and make sure that there aren't resources sitting dormant in another part of the district that we can utilize. And so that is kind of the process we're going through right now. I also want to have Ms. McCombs respond to Camera's comment about the science curriculum in particular. I want you to hear from her, and we can certainly follow up additionally.
Okay. So, Cameron, thank you for raising the point about the gaps. When we look at the curriculum between Algebra 2 and AP Calculus, I think that was your specific concern. So what I can assure you is that I'll look into working with Dr. Brockington and also with our Chief Academic Officer, Mr. Andrew Bell, to make sure that we can figure out some support to find out what we can put in place until the problem is solved and resolved completely. I'm not going to tell you it's going to be overnight, but until we solve it completely, at least we can put some supports in place so that you feel equipped and assured, because you're very intelligent, that you can achieve and that you have everything at your disposal to be able to achieve in those advanced math courses. So continue to raise your voice, continue to raise your concerns, because that holds us accountable and makes us honest. So we will be able to tackle that for you. You're welcome.
So thank you all again for the feedback.
Oh, yes. Oh, sorry. Apologies. I couldn't see you. The line of sight.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Adriana Harris. I'm the Wilson rep. And today I wanted to talk about, address my concern on the curriculum that we're being taught, but not me personally, but students in my school, when they read publicly, they have a hard time pronouncing words out of books that we read. And it's all due to how much they're putting into us in reading and the books that we have to read, how hard they are, college level, stuff like that. Most people in my classes, even the seniors, and I'm a junior, they struggle on words that I don't struggle on. And I feel like it's not fair for them to have to struggle on things when they're gonna have to go to college and be behind. Or the seniors having to take extra math classes, extra reading classes for classes they already should have known, things that they already should have been taught. And I was just wondering what they could do to help for me when I'm a senior or the freshman now, to where they don't have to do all the extra things and already be prepared like other districts.
So, I mean, you're raising arguably the greatest challenge we have, which is how do we move all students up simultaneously? You're exactly right in that we have a lot of students that are below grade level in certain subject areas, and then we have other students that are on grade level or above grade level, and how can we be a rising tide that lifts all boats? And at Woodrow Wilson and Camden High, we have this double down literacy and math initiative so that we are spending half the class time doing on grade level work, meaning if a ninth grade student happens to be at sixth grade level in math, they're working in a blended learning environment on a computer independently with some support from a teacher with on-grade level materials, but the instruction for the other half of the class is on-grade level material. And so, you know, we have these initiatives in place to help address the very challenge that you're raising. It's really, really hard work in terms of students being at various grade levels and in various subjects. Ms. McCombs, I don't know if there's anything you want to add there.
I'll just underscore what the superintendent has already said. There are lots of initiatives that are in place. I don't know if you're familiar with Edmentum and RE-180, System 44, but there are different tools that are in place so that as we try to close that achievement gap, and that's exactly what you're talking about, when you talk about students who are not reading the way they should or not feeling confident in the way that they're verbalizing or expressing or breaking down their words, we're finding that because the gap widened, and that started way back when they were either in kindergarten, first grade, or second grade, which is why we're trying to strengthen at the early childhood level so we can prevent against that. But for those students who have already risen past that and who are in the place that you talk about, who are struggling, we have those other supports in place. So in addition to what the superintendent said about the double down reading and math, combined with student effort, student hard work, really digging in, it's not a one-sided thing. So I want to just make sure that I articulate and express, we're going to continue to do everything that we can to create new intervention strategies, which just means that we're going to try to think outside of the box to figure out how to make it so that we don't have students who are not feeling confident in their ability to read. But at the same time, I want to encourage you as student leaders and student reps to share with your schools and your colleagues that hard work is still something that they will have to put in as well. So on both sides, we are accountable, but we need to hold each other accountable to make sure that we're all doing the best by each other. So I'd be happy, though, to keep talking to you more about other options and other solutions. But you raised that very well. Thank you.
And Superintendent, if I may, and I know you all given the programmatic results to bringing reading levels up, but if I may say especially to our young people here, to the young women and to the young men who will soon be fathers and mothers, if I can say this to the community, that we should read more to our children when they're in the womb. I just want to make that, you know, clear, because we know we all as adults going to do our part and do what we have to do. But how we can add to that is if the parents, it doesn't matter how young you are, how old you are, you should really read while you're going through those 9 months of pregnancy. You should read to your children while they're in the womb, as well as early childhood step up and plans we're doing. And to the young men that's out there who's going to be soon to be fathers, encourage the young ladies to read to the children when they're pregnant. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Minister Mohammed. My last comment on especially the request for ink, and clearly we need to move faster. So that is a commitment I will make first thing tomorrow to check in on where we are, because we've gotten this feedback from you all just a few days ago, and so we need to move a bit more quickly. So we'll follow up with you all there. And on technology, we need to that's a longer conversation as far as how we can triage resources. I mean, when I hear that access to certain equipment at Woodrow Wilson isn't there, like, that's a little bit of a head scratcher for me. I mean, Ms. Blackshear reminded me we had a large technology program there that was implemented 2 years ago and purchased a brand new set of tablets. And so we just need to make sure that those are being utilized optimally. So we'll follow up on all fronts there. I appreciate your feedback as always. All right. Yes, Ms. Wilson.
I'm sorry, I should have addressed this earlier, but I just wanted to say thank you for us getting a Director of Career and Technical Education. I know we've been asking for that since the beginning of school. Actually, we asked for it before, but thank you now for actually putting someone in place. We thank you.
And you know, on that note, one of our growth areas in CUSAC was to build out career and technical education.
Right.
And pleased to say we've now hired Director of CTE, his name is Al Dyer, so those of you that know him, he has a wonderful reputation here with our students and with our staff, former Camden High Administrator, so he will be starting in January. So I'm glad you called that out. Thank you, Ms. Wilson.
Thank you.
All right, so we will now transition to public commentary.
Rules for public comment. The Camden City School District welcomes the attendance and comments from all members of the public at its meetings. The public comment period is your time to be heard on the agenda items in this meeting. Each person who signed up to comment will have 3 minutes. You will be notified when your 3 minutes are up. You cannot yield your time to another person. When it is your turn to speak, please remain at the podium and address all of your comments to the board president or the superintendent. Please conduct yourself in a respectful and courteous manner. For anyone whose comments or actions either harass, intimidate, or threaten the safety of any person, we will provide you with a warning or immediately end your comment time. Also, if you curse, use vulgar language, or make personal attacks, we will provide you with a warning or end your comment time. We will not interrupt you during your 3 minutes of comments. Members of the audience should also not interrupt the speaker at the podium. If you have any questions, please ask your questions during your 3 minute comment period. After the public comment period is closed, the superintendent or his designee will address your questions to the extent provided by law. First speaker is Elizabeth Ortiz.
Good evening. So like always, I'll jump right into it. The No Child Left Behind Act of 2001, the one-size-fits-all bill, has been replaced with ESSA, Every Student Succeeds Act. The question you need to ask yourself is, how does this affect New Jersey? Or better yet, how does this affect Camden City Public Schools? While Dave Hespy from the Department of Education says that this will not affect New Jersey classrooms, I say it's about time things start changing. With ESSA now in place, we can gain back local control, and we will. See, the No Child Left Behind Act, according to USA Today, said that states wanting federal funding were required to fix schools that failed to improve test scores adequately. Those interventions started out with softer measures, but after 5 years, the school had a limited number of dire choices: fire the principal and most of the staff, convert to charter school, lengthen the school day or year, or close the school down entirely. We have seen each and every one of those things happen here in our city. The time to act is now. It is time to gain local control. We cannot continue to be sitting ducks. Even the Democratic presidential candidate Hillary Clinton said, and I quote, most charter schools, they don't take the hardest to teach children, or if they do, they don't keep them. And so the public schools are often in a no-win situation. Clinton has supported the idea of charters in the past as a choice, but not as a replacement for public schools. Another topic needing to be addressed is the lack of science within our district. There is a billboard that I pass twice a day, every day on Route 130. It's a billboard advertising U.S. sciences, and it says, and I quote, top 10 in the nation in salary after graduation. So now the question becomes, what are we doing for our students to have access to that opportunity? I took the liberty of looking up annual salaries for scientists. A botanist in 2014 earned an average of $93,000 a year. A biotech scientist earned between $99,000 and $124,000. Physicists earned an average of $106,000. Astrophysicists working for the Smithsonian Institute earned $57,000 in 2013, while astrophysicists working for the U.S. Navy earned $131,000. Pharmaceutical scientists take the cake, making an average of $138,000 with a $23,000 bonus and $4,000 of outside income for an average total of $165,000. And their top 25 pharmaceutical companies paid their employees $171,000 with a $30,000 in bonuses for an average total of $201,000 for the year 2012. And those are just some to name a few. So what are you going to do? How are you going to open up these quality opportunities for our children here in the city? And as always, parents, please advocate and don't let your child be the statistic. Help them be the anomaly.
Number two, Ulysses Delgado.
Ulysses Delgado, 3197 Federal Street. Mr. Superintendent, I talked to you a couple months ago regarding Kramer School, big drug activity right next to the school. My grandkids go to that school there. I do not want them to see these drug dealers in there. They have locked up the last couple months, over 30. But these people are just like roaches, they keep coming back. I want it to stop. We have brought the dogs over. We locked the owner up from the house. The one across the street's been locked up. I want you to do the best you can to stop this from going on in that school right there. I have spoken to the principal. I have spoken to the freeholders. I told Mr. Lou Capello, you live in Collinswood, how would you like your grandkids to go to right next to a place where they'd be selling drugs? This is not. He said he was going to call you up. Did he call you up?
He did not, but the police department reached out to me about it on your urging.
And it's critical. East Camden is getting bad. It's a war zone out there now. I've been out there working with the cops, and I'm going after these drug dealers. I'm a community activist. I'm the highest taxpayer in the city of Camden. I'm not scared of these drug dealers. I lost two brothers back in the day from drug dealing. They were there at the wrong time. And my father was shot 5 times in his business in the city of Camden. I'm tired of seeing this violence in the city. And it's the residents' fault what's happening in the city of Camden. Our residents in the city of Camden are not standing up, not paying attention to their kids. They're partying out there. They think they're still young. I raised seven kids. I adopted 4 kids from a drug family. They all graduated from college. It's the parents' fault why our kids are failing here. And a lot of kids in Wilder Wilson School can't hardly even read. It's a shame what's going on to our residents. You must stand up. Mr. Superintendent, it's time. You found money for Pine Point to make it a junior high school, a high school over there. We need a vocational school. Why should we be giving all our good money to Pensauken Vocational School? Let's bring all this technology into Wilder Wilson High School. I walk with the principal around there. We need new computers in Wilder Wilson High School. We need this new technology for these kids. These kids, I want them to succeed and become somebody in life, not become drug dealers like what's going on in the city. We must pay attention to our kids, what's happening in the city of Camden right here. It's our fault. We continue to elect the same people into office, like Mr. Frank Moran. Lives in East Camden. Supposed to be my representative. He's not paying attention to Kramer School. That's around the corner where he lives. I ran. I knew I wasn't going to win because I can't beat the machine, but at least I try to make a difference in the city. I'm about to retire pretty soon, and I'll be moving to Texas where I can feel safe and good things happen. But I have
Thank
another
you, Mr.
year
Delgado,
and a half to
your
go.
Your time is up.
I appreciate my superintendent. Take care of the
Number 3, R. Mangaliso.
R. Mangaliso Davis, glad to be black. Madam Chair, Vice Chair, Chair President, to the board, to the council, to the students, listen, you deserve everything and more than sending money back. Keep bringing your voices and concerns here so we can know, the community know. Don't let nobody stifle what you bring. We want to know what's going on. If they don't teach you right, they will not treat you right. Okay? That. Happy Kwanzaa to everyone. I know everybody's into that Christmas thing. 35 million people worldwide, black, to celebrate Kwanzaa. Is anybody in the school going to do Kwanzaa? Get on the stick. And when Black history come up, 28 days, 300 years of history in this country here. And you ain't going to do it in 28 days. You should have something every day. Teach those people who can't teach you, because they don't know. Celebrate yourself. Now, down to business. I got to see a report here. Everyone here that know people in Centerville that go to Cream School, you are deputized to let every parent that had a child that was going to Cream School, they was exposed to fungus and botulism. If you have a respiratory problem, you will have serious problems, and the parents do not know that. The school district did not let the parents know. There are teachers right now that are having problems. So everybody to hear my voice, you let those people in Centerville, Woodland, or over in Whitman Park know that their children have been exposed and they have problems they will never tell you. Now, and they said that they took and scrubbed the walls down to get the fungus off the walls. The people who did it were not qualified. The janitors are not qualified to remove fungus off the walls. This guy, Smith's coat. Now, closing on this here. I, Oprah, the break-in reports. Listen, Mr. Groundskeeper Nicholos, he needs to leave right away. If he's here at the next month, this district is going to be exposed to incompetent on your part, Mr. Superintendent, because this man has been engaged in some scrupulous things and some other things that have happened in this district for a whole year, and y'all don't know nothing about it. Now, Mr. Solicitor, I understand that you got four more attorneys, so I know you've been looking over the documents that we have brought. You need to bring it before I bring it. You need to bring it before I bring it. You need to get that guy out of here. Okay?
Number four, Vida Neal.
Good evening. My name is Vida Neal, and I'm Camden's only political blogger. Let me tell you how I got started. I got started when my niece came to my house and told me that she went to Bonzel School. And that Bonzel School is now uncommon. The third floor of Bonzel has been renovated to the uncommon school. Now today we were in Trenton, where the superintendents of each district had to speak to the state senators. Mr. Rahanifer spoke. You did not tell the truth, sir. It is on my Facebook page because I blogged every word that you said. And anybody who don't believe me, go to Vida Neal, send me a Facebook request, friend request, and hear all the stories that Mr. Rahanifer had to say. Now, Mr. Rahanifer, you told those people that you renovated that Bonzel School from the ground up. You told a story, sir. You renovated the third floor. The children on the first and second floor in a regular public school have nothing. They got the swish boards, the iPads. You just want these children to go into these Renaissance schools. The Renaissance schools are not teaching the children. I have a video called, "If You Spend 2 Hours Teaching Your Children, You Are the New Teacher." They send homework packets. When I was in school, the curriculum, you took home the homework, reflected what you learned in school. Therefore, if you did not know the homework, you got beaten because your mom knew you didn't pay attention in school. But now we got these Renaissance schools sending home homework packets. Something else I want to touch on, Cooper Point. Special education, they don't have paraprofessionals. You got 16 kids to one teacher, special ed. You also lied today when you told the senators that only 200 children are outside the district, special needs. Let me tell you something. The big money is with the special needs children. Why are you sending them outside of the district, giving our money outside our community? You need a place in this city for the special needs children, okay? You told a lot of lies today, and you can turn off the mic, because I'm not done yet. Now, you are taking teachers from Teacher Source. Norcross is a little part-time teacher thing. You're rotating them every 20 days at Camden High and Woodrow Wilson. The children do not have permanent teachers from Teacher Source. See, I'm up on your games, buddy, and let me tell you something else I want to tell you. What happened to your chief of security? Let me pull up my pants for this one. Because, see, we got kids here, and I got to keep it clean. What happened to your chief of security? He was fired. Why? What was he doing after hours? With who? You got a whole scandal going on in your office, Payment. I want you to know that people in your office text me. Because what's being done to our children, I'm not going to stand by and let it. I am here to fight for the children of City of Camden. I graduated 4 children out of Camden school system. I just had my 35th reunion
Thank
at Camden
you, Ms.
High.
Neal, your time
Class
is up.
Of 80. We are going to get rid of you. You are a destroyer. You are here to destroy our public schools. We are going to take back over control of our school system. And decide what is best for our children.
Thank you, Ms. Neal. Your time is up. Number 5, Joyce Carter.
I missed the last board meeting, but I was told there were some teachers here and they would not let them in the meeting. Remember, board meeting is public. I'm glad I wasn't there. You probably had to call the cops. Then you have teachers that are being brought up on tenure charges. And it seems to me, I remember when Dr. Webster, that was superintendent of schools, and he recruited a lot of black males, folks that are sitting up there. I came through Camden School District, and I taught it over 40 years. And I know what I'm talking about. And these folks are tearing this district apart, and you can't see it? We from Camden fought for you and opened up the doors, but I never thought and believe that this would be going on. Check it out. Forest Hill especially. I know 2 of them have a meeting tomorrow. You have the young man that came over from Pennsylvania working underneath the principal at Woodrow Wilson's going around here evaluating people. Are they qualified? No. A lot of our good teachers have left. And one of them, I was shocked. One of the best guidance counselors that I had ever worked with, and she's gone. You have students that were sent from Whittier School to Norcross's school that he shouldn't have had it. And they have to go in the back door. I heard that in the doctor's office. Everybody's looking strange. You got to go around here and find out what's going on. Now, when everyone came in, I hear everybody's plight in this country. We have had over 200 years of lynching. And in the community, Camden's known as a plantation. And if you can't see it, and I'm sick and tired of our students are not looking at teachers that look like us. Give me a break. We had mentors in this district. And a lot of things that you're talking about bringing back, the curriculum was set up. And I know that's here. And you can ask, I know the principal I worked under was Pat Cook. We had advanced placement. We had all of that. And you're going around in a merry-go-round. And then I hear that, oh, we're going to have in-house suspension. We had that. You came in and tore it apart. And I would like to see the curriculum. Usually at board meetings, when people come, you have copies for them.
Thank you, Ms. Carter. Your time is up.
One last thing, and I'll say this aloud. You had a petition to
you better check those names out. And some of them probably still are not here legally.
Number 6, Gary Frazier.
Good evening. So I want to touch on a number of things tonight. First of all, how is everybody doing? I'm here to talk to you guys about Bill 68453, which was the No Child Left Behind bill. And that was passed by both houses of Congress by a vote of 85 to 12. So basically what happens now is that your annual testing remains, but the responsibility for performance and accountability now reverts back to states in the district. This law makes it more important than ever for parents to be engaged in their children's education at the state and local level. So it will keep the existing annual testing requirements in reading and math, and it requires that states act to improve the lowest performing schools. It allows more local control to set goals, to determine school ratings, and to decide remedial measures. November the 9th, S2881/A4485, which is pertaining to PART. As you guys know, you guys do have a refusal. You guys do not have to take the test. It was signed into law prohibiting the withholding of state funds on the basis of state test refusal numbers, opt out. This test also prevents high-stakes standardized testings from being given to our young students, K through second grade. So they don't have to take it. And now on to my business. So I hear about a project coming in the Parkside area with Uncommon School, 76,615 square footage, coming in there at $31.8 million, targeting areas in the schools of K through 4, 5 through 8, 9 through 12. I'm not the sharpest tool in the shed, but I can tell you that if I'm looking at the schools that are in that area that they anticipate to be targeting, then that tells me that a number of schools will be closing. I'm looking at possibly Hatch, Forest Hill, somewhere down the line, Camden High. Let me make myself clear. I live in Parkside, and there are a number of community leaders that live in the Parkside area. If you guys think for 1 minute we're gonna let y'all walk $31.7 million into that district for one school, you have lost your minds. There will be pushback. There will be a pushback for those educators. See, the problem that we keep having is you have these organizations getting together to have these backdoor meetings to decide the future fates of these educators, to decide the future fates of these public schools that we have here. Yet we have our children telling us that they don't have ink in their schools, but we're taking $31.7 million and investing it in one school. We're spending, and wait, here's the thing, $1,500 per pupil. $1,500 per pupil. So that means you're telling me you're targeting 75, your target is 75, you're capping out at 90, and that's just for your K to 4 of your 5th through 8th students, and then
thank you,
you're targeting
Frazier,
140 and 160 students for our high school, but you want to tell us that you're stepping in to do some remediations to Camden High. We cannot continue to sit down at this table, have a conversation with lives. The community is not to be played with, all right? If you want the community to actively engage, then you must be fair. You must lay all cards on the table. These educators that are here play a significant role in our children's lives, okay?
Thank you, Mr. Frazier. Your time is up.
You guys are ripping educators out of these children's lives. These educators have been around for decades, and I understand top down, bottom up. I understand budget cuts and all that. But you are not taking a look at the impact that it's having on these children. Our children are coming to school. They're coming to school happy, leaving out of school angry. So we are not getting down to the core problems, and I have not begun to address you on special needs. I will not air this dirty laundry in this meeting, because I'm giving you the opportunity to fix it.
Number 7, Kevin Waters.
Good evening, everyone. I'm a little curious. I'm curious to understand how there is a mindset to make Pine Point a high school. This behooves me. First, Pine Point graduated thousands of students into high school over the years, and most have turned out to be very successful. That's way before this charter school nonsense. So again, if those schools had the resources, we wouldn't even be standing here with this kind of a conversation of separate but equal, but it's really unequal. That's really what it is. Let me ask you a question. Did the signatures that were gotten, obtained, legitimately North Camden residents? How were they verified? Who made the verification? What was the vetting process? What will the impact of the lost revenue from the traditional public schools where infrastructure and educational resources are severely deficient at both Woodrow Wilson and Camden High, who, as it has been stated, don't have a librarian and are in need of upgraded technology? I made it to school every day. Most days I got there on time. That was when I was going to Pine Point. During those days, it was dangerous to be African-American walking through Cranmer Hill, coming from North Camden to Woodrow Wilson, where marauding white kids walked the streets. My parents were not rich and struggled to get us bus tickets. Again, we made it to school every day in the snow. Winter temps were not the balmy 40s and 30s they are today. The complaint of today's parents who want Pine Point to be a high school is baseless and really not a drastic need, but a want. Poverty in 1969 was pervasive then. It is now, but our parents still then required us to make it to school. Another question, did the advisory board have an option to close one of the failing charter schools and take that money and provide bus transportation for the students of North Camden? Did that happen? Cherry Hill's got a bus transportation system, Pensacola's got one, Collinswood's got one. Now, they have fewer students in their district than Camden. And trust me, they could be a commuter district, but they're not. There is, again, no need. No. Let me ask this question. Can you explain the role of a board member's spouse to the district? I don't recall such a relationship where there was an elected school board in Camden, when there was one. I could be corrected. However, there appears to be such a relationship with this advisory board. I'm not saying there is, but the optics are there that a board member's spouse has influence over the school district, and he's not employed there. Do I have this correct, Mr. Superintendent? You're empowered to, this is what your job is. The Board of Education provides oversight. Well, we don't have a Board of Education. We have an advisory board, but they don't do a lot of advising, apparently. The superintendent does not appear to be happening to be an agent with the board. He appears to be operating independently of the board. Transportation, Mr. Superintendent, can be an enormous role for a superintendent, but it is one of your roles. You could use transportation to support those students who want a high school in North Camden to be bused to East Camden. I got there.
Thank you, Mr. Waters. Your time is up.
Every day, I got there. Every day, I got there. Every day, I got there. I'm just saying.
Sean Brown. 8th speaker.
Okay. Good evening.
Good evening.
I wanted to just touch on two things, one very generally, one very specifically. So first, tonight, as usual, we hear a lot of the same issues come up, whether it's from the superintendent in his presentation, the student representatives, or from public comment. We heard about suspensions and the student code of conduct. We heard about curriculum, either questions on explaining why things are the way they are now or an update for new things that will be coming out. Teacher diversity and the way we staff people in this district, special needs and what the district is doing in terms of how it relates to special education students, including how we outsource it for a few hundred students. College access and the process the students have as they apply for college, get accepted, and how the school district supports those things. Policies in general, from the policy manual to the way specific approved policies are implemented in the schools. And career and technical education with the hiring of Mr. Dyer. We also hear of a great divide between both an education philosophy and the priorities that are made. I'm gonna get back to that and switch to another issue. And one, I briefly was able to talk to the student representatives about this last month, but I wanna say that there is some low-hanging fruit. There's some easy victories that we can have that do the most important thing that any of us in a position of power can do in education, which is to make sure the students are getting what our Constitution refers to as a thorough and efficient education, right? The best education that they possibly can within all the resources that we have. One way that we can support our students right now with very little effort, yet with a huge return, especially as our seniors apply for college, is to change our grade scale of how students' grades, the number grade reflects the letter grade that's given. For over 10 years in this district, an A starts at 93. This is uncommon. It's so uncommon, I could not find it in any other district in the United States of America. This is an issue that's existed for a long period of time, but could be fixed fairly quickly. The example that many of you have heard me give already is that I can have all 92s in my report card in Camden, which would be a B, which would make my GPA a 3.0. And then my best friend that lives in Cherry Hill can have all 91s, which are all A's, and a 4.0, even though I actually have a higher numerical grade. When I have briefly mentioned this, and it was less than a 20-second conversation, I admit, the answer was that this is something that will be addressed at a later time. And I understand priorities and how they go, and a district like Camden has so many issues. However, I would just add that as students are applying for college right now and need to put their GPA as a part of that application, that the grade scale needs to be adjusted to reflect the way we do this in the rest of America. And beyond that, the GPAs need to be recalculated from freshman year until now so that senior students have an opportunity to be very competitive at the best schools so they can get scholarships and do all those things to do it.
Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Thank
your
you.
Time is up.
All right.
Number 10th speaker is Charlene Shepherd.
Good evening, everyone. And first and foremost, I would like to congratulate and let you students up there know I am very proud of you guys. I was always taught a closed mouth do not get fed. And I hope y'all get able to eat, okay? Now, foremost, my name is Charlene Shepherd, and I'm here to stand strong for my son, Muhammad A. Blackson, Camden High School. Mr. Paymon, I spoke to you last week, and as of today, I have no action. In my hand, I hold three things. One is my son's report card that went from last year from a 1.5 to a 3.0. My mother's obituary, and still I stand strong. My son's best friend's obituary, and still I stand strong. My son was on the verge of dropping out of school last year because of the death of my mother, which is his grandmother, which we traveled 13 hours in the ice storm, if you guys remember, 3-3-14. By the time we got there, her body was cold to touch. her face disheveled. There was blood pouring out of every opening in her face. And yes, he did see that, but still I stand, okay? He was on the verge of dropping out of school. So you know what I did? I went back to school to let him know, yes, we can, okay? He has a 3.0 this year. He started out in the Camden High School 9th grade basketball team, one of the highest scorers on that team. And still, I stand. Last year, he did not get on the team because, like I said, he had a 1.5, struggled to get a 2.5. And once he achieved his goals, the varsity coach, which the JV coach encouraged him to get on the bus to support the team. The varsity coach said, why are you on my bus? I have never seen the disheveled look on my son's face, okay, like that. And now he's cut. My son go to sleep with a basketball. He bounce a basketball. He can dribble a basketball. He can shoot a basketball, okay? And when I open up this book and when it goes to Camden High, I see mentorship. Where is it at? Where is it at? We face death in this world every day. And that's the one thing that's promised is death. So why should my son die in these streets? Why do he not deserve to be on that basketball team? Is it called winning a game or winning in life? Okay? And still, I stand. Muhammad A. Blackson, can we have some attention, please?
Number 12, Sarah Jocelyn.
Very powerful witness there. I would like to thank the young people for speaking out. And I will remind the board that last month, there was no ink in Camden High. There was no ink in Woodrow Wilson then. I was at this meeting last month, and they reported the same issue then. They talked about the issue of no librarians. That's been talked about a number of times here. So I just want to set this record straight there. Met East has a library because they got a grant. It was not a reallocation of resources within this district. It was a grant that they received to allow them to have additional resources. So let's be clear about that. I came today to talk to you about the issue of slavery. I'm talking about slavery here. This is the 150th anniversary of the 13th Amendment this month. Slavery was outlawed in the United States. 150 years. We need to teach our children that slavery is outlawed in this country. We need to teach them that from the youngest age. They need to know that. It concerns me when even one child in North Camden is afraid that he will be enslaved. January is Human Trafficking Awareness Month. It's National Slavery and Human Trafficking Prevention Month. Human trafficking is the modern day slavery. Young children are at risk. We need to protect our young children. We need to have awareness of families of that risk. And it's not an issue that's just in Camden City. It's in all cities. It's in the rural part of the country. It's not something that happens overseas. It's here. We need to be educating our adults. We need to make sure our children are safe. It is an illegal thing to hold someone against their will and enslave them, to make them work, to use force or the threat of force or coercion for benefit of another person. We need to be aware of that issue. We need to talk about that issue. We need to make sure that our young people understand it and that they are aware of the risk that they're at. When you're talking about 12-year-olds, 13-year-olds, those children feel, well, I know what's going on. They can be at risk, and it doesn't take very much for them to disappear, be moved, be outside of the area, and be under coercion. Please make sure that this is addressed in January and through the school systems. Thank you.
Number 13, Keith Howe. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Loretta Goodman, Loretta Gooden, number 11.
Good afternoon. My name is Loretta Gooden. I'm the president of the District Parent Advisory Council. I've been waiting on answers and issues that I've asked for in closed doors. Now I'm here to put it out here for parents to know. We've been trying for 5 years to get a parent university. Community engagement has it. That was our baby. We asked for quite a few things. I don't want to put everything out there. But I can't understand why everybody else is getting what they're supposed to have. Mr. Paymon, you was there last month when we had our community engagement. Nobody showed up. I don't know if you looked into it, but I would really like to know if you found out why the coordinators didn't bring the parents. I have been told from several people that they were told, the coordinators were told not to bring the parents to our meetings. I don't think that's fair. The parent, it's true that they have information, but the information that we give the parents is to help these children, to help them not raise their children, but know what their rights are, to know the law. I hear parents, people out here speaking. They're speaking, but do they really know the law? You can quote numbers, but to know what you know, these parents are not getting it. Our meetings, we had a district meeting last week. Nobody showed up but myself and the vice president. Nothing went out. I need to know, why are we being shut down? Why are we, everything that we have worked so hard for? I've been in this district working with parents and children for 35 years, and I have never been so calm down, Loretta. Been so hurt in my life to see the disrespect the parents are getting in this city. We have never had that before. We stood for something. Children knew us like we knew the children. You took the parents out of the schools. I have to say that was a little before you. But we used to be in there. All this nonsense that's going on in these schools didn't happen when the parents were there. Now your parents go in, you gotta make an appointment. Why you gotta make an appointment? It's your child's school, you can't go in. I can see if they wanted to talk to the teacher during the time that the teacher's supposed to be in the school, but this doesn't make sense. We have children that needs to see parents just to know, oh, if I mess up, they gonna tell my mama.
Thank you, Ms. Gooden, your time is up. Number 13, Keith Howe.
Good evening. My name is Keith Howe, and I'm a teacher and an advocate for our African American and Latino students at Woodrow Wilson High School. I would like to speak to you about our lack of a librarian and the lack of research skills. Research skills are an essential part of college. Students who have not been exposed to proper researching techniques are at an immediate disadvantage once they reach the undergraduate level. The 21st century librarian not only facilitates reading, checking in, and checking out books, the librarian is essential in maintaining an online catalog of texts within the library itself. The modern college course requires research. Research within the library takes training. Students who are unfamiliar with techniques for locating texts for their respective topics need to learn these skills. Schools need a library professional that is capable in showing students how to search for relevant texts. Simply having a body in the library will not cut it. Students are stepping into a world that requires computer skills for success. The Rutgers Library, for example, is a seven-level maze of paperback, hardcover, and electronic resources. Fortunately, three college professors from Rutgers Camden have decided to prepare our social studies honor students in online research. They are helping us prepare for the upcoming National History Essay Contest. I also want to share with you a letter I received from a student of mine. It also gives an accurate picture of what we do at Woodrow Wilson, even though we don't get maximum exposure from the superintendent. Quote, I am tired of everyone assuming how bad they think Woodrow Wilson High School is. I spent my freshman and sophomore years of high school in Camden Academy Charter School. I received a 3.0 in my freshman year and a 3.6 in my sophomore year. In my first marking period as a junior at Woodrow Wilson High School, I have a 4.4 GPA. Thanks to Ms. Pruitt, our college guidance officer, I have been to four college fairs in 2 months. When at Charter, we only had one once a year. The biggest difference between these schools is the vast technology and materials given to charters. In case you didn't know, charter students are being provided with their own personal Chromebooks and iPad minis to do their assignments. That gives them opportunities to do their work in any given place or time. Our public schools aren't as financially stable as charter schools, who receive a constant flow of money from billionaires. The day my mother went to get my transfer, she was told many false things about Wilson just to get me to stay. She was told teachers did not care about their students. The environment was not stable. No one cared if the students succeeded or not. And that if I would not graduate because I would get influenced by the other failures at the school. Well, I am one of the top 15 students, and I am part of the meetings that speak to the superintendent every third of the month. I'm on the road to success, and Wilson is on the rise. Woodrow Wilson High School is the school choice. End of quote. Mr. Howe stands
thank you,
on
Mr.
Psalms
Howe,
127.
Your time is up.
Children are like arrows in the hand of a mighty man, and so are the children of youth. Happy is the man who has his crib full of them. He shall stand with the enemy in the gate. Thank you.
Number 14, Helen Ferrante.
Good evening. I come to these board meetings to learn about the positive achievements and the new advances that our district is making and striving to accomplish. However, all I have learned is that we have less, but are expected to do more. Teachers must wear many different hats in order to be effective and successful. This is nothing new, but now we have to put on a different kind of hat because we are expected to be business-minded individuals, to promote our own schools, to compete with other schools within the district for prospective students, to gain their families' interest so they'll enroll their children in our specific schools. Also, we can increase or at least maintain enrollment while decreasing the odds the district selects our school for closure. Meanwhile, we have less means to fix rundown technology, and we even have to ask individual donors for basic supplies. It's such a dysfunctional relationship between the board and the schools, as if the district wants its schools to fail. It's as if the very wolf gave us the strong sticks and told us to build a school. When teachers speak up, they are criticized, or worse, simply ignored. This negativity has driven good teachers away from the teaching profession in Camden. It seems to me that this new form of business management is an old school form of bullying. This brings up another point. I recently had the opportunity to speak with a new student at Yorkshire, As I was speaking with him, he brought up that he had previously attended Mastery North Camden School at Pine Point. He said that he couldn't take it at Mastery anymore. He was constantly being bullied there. No one would listen to him. He said kids are bullied there regularly. The teachers and administrators are fully aware of it, but do nothing to stop it. He came to Yorkshire because his dad said that it is better over here. I informed him that bullying is not tolerated at Yorkshire and to see me if he had any problems. He smiled and said, I will, Mrs. F. Why is this permitted at Mastery Charter School? I believe there is a law that protects the victims of bullying and there are strict guidelines on how to deal with it. It is imperative that this administration look into this matter so that other students do not suffer in silence. Is Mastery Charter School a truly safe environment for our children? Or is the charter school system a loophole to avoid scrutiny in these matters? Another point on charter schools. Last week, I went to the Cherry Hill School Board meeting. There, I was shocked to see that the Cherry Hill District had paid out over $184,000 for approximately 10 students to go to charter schools here in Camden. I'm a bit confused. I thought these charter schools were for Camden children, so they would have a choice of schools to attend. Why are children from Cherry Hill permitted into these charter schools? Why are taxes being used to fund a charter school? In addition, if Cherry Hill School District is paying $184,000 for those students, how much does the Camden City District pay for the students who go to the charter schools? It is supposed to be public knowledge, and I would like to compare the two findings. Finally, the new curriculum is missing pieces throughout the grades. It is also missing pertinent supplies, such as books for each grade level classroom.
Thank you, Ms. Ferrante. Your time is up.
I'm not done.
Ms. Ferrante, your time is up. Ms. Ferrante, your time is up. Please leave the podium.
Mr. Hanifer will be attending the roundtable discussions, which are designed for teacher input on different district ideas and initiatives.
Number 15, Kelly Francis.
Good evening, board members. Mr. Rahanathan, if you recall, I believe it was about 2 years ago, I believe it was your first public meeting, I addressed you and I addressed the board, and I stated at that time that your purpose for being here was not to replace Reuben Mills, who was the acting superintendent at the time. I said your purpose here is to convert our public schools to charters, renaissance, school choice, or vouchers, or anything that diverts funding from the public schools to these other entities. And if you recall that conversation, and it seemed as though I was spot on, I was absolutely correct in my assessment of your purpose for coming to this district. This is exactly what has happened. Also, last year, the governor came to town, a big hullabaloo, press conference, front page news articles, $50 million to be allocated for Camden High School. Well, here we are, another year, nothing's happened. But also within that 1 year period, when he came with that big announcement, press conference about the $50 million for Camden High, we've had the Kipper. KIPP, Cooper Norcross Academy, $45 million facility, 5 city blocks has been erected and is operational. We've had another LEAP, STEAM High School. They've coined a new phrase, STEAM instead of STEM. So they've added arts to another 12-story high school. All this is within the time that since Christie came to town with his $50 million announcement, okay? And we also have been told that Mashpee will be converting Pine Point to a high school, and also there will be Uncommon and also we'll be getting into the high school business. Now, I'll make another prediction, that one of our high schools is going to remain open, one of the comprehensive high schools, either Camden High or Woodrow Wilson. And the reason one of them has to remain open, because you have to have a dumping ground for the students from all these other Renaissance and charter high schools, okay? The students that low performing or problem students who are negatively maybe affecting their performance records, there has to be some place for those students to be dumped or sent back. But of course, the money will not follow them. The Charter Renaissance School will keep the money, but they will be sending the students back to either Camden High or Woodrow Wilson. That's why one of them has to remain open, because there has to be a dump. This is reminiscent of the 60s and 70s when we had two Catholic high schools in the city, Camden Catholic High School and also St. Joe's. And that's what they did. All the students that they, undesirable students that they did not want, they would send them back to Camden High or Woodrow Wilson. You know, they would dump them or kick them out of the Catholic school. So this thing is repeating itself. Here we are, history repeating itself.
Thank
this
you,
is
Mr.
The
Francis,
purpose.
Your time is
this
up.
This is why I'm predicting that one of the comprehensive high schools will remain open for a big government. And one other question. The young lady mentioned the AP, calculus AP. What I want to know is that is trigonometry being taught along with the math curriculum in our high school? Because trigonometry is a vital component of the science of the calculus curriculum.
Thank you, Mr. Francis. Your time is up. Public comment is over.
Thank you, Mr. Francis. All right, so I'm going to go through the specific questions and comments that were raised. I'm going to start with Ms. Vida. Is she still here? Thought I saw her leave. All right, so she raised paraprofessional vacancies at Cooper's Point, and there are a number of vacancies there. So there are 22 total paraprofessional positions at Cooper's Point. Only one is vacant, and so we are actively working to staff that one position. With out-of-district placement, so the district is required to provide special education services that kids need, it goes without saying, and in some cases those needs are so significant that the district is unable to provide them. And so we are trying certainly to build our programmatic capacity so that we can keep those students within the district, and that is an ongoing conversation we're having, but it is not uncommon to see the out-of-district placements when we're unable to meet the special education services as required on the IEP. Ms. Vida, I just saw you walk back in. Cooper's Point, there's only one paraprofessional vacancy. You had raised that. 22 total paraprofessional positions, there's only one vacancy. As far as Source for Teachers, we've certainly had a big conversation about Source for Teachers here. There's basically a lot of misinformation. With Source for Teachers, we predominantly utilize substitutes when a teacher is calling out sick. It is not driven by vacancies. The vast, vast majority of our vacancies have to do with high-need staffing areas, which every school district in the country is dealing with that challenge, where you don't have enough certified teachers for special education and for math and science. And so the vast majority, when we call Source for Teachers to provide a subs, has to do with daily call-outs. And if you talk with teachers who were working in the district before we had the substitute pool, they will tell you that it is a huge support to schools, because teachers would have to cover for each other because the substitute pool isn't big enough to provide coverage across all of our schools. So it is a good thing. We don't depend on them in the way that I've heard some people discuss it publicly. And so if anyone wants specific numbers, we can tell you what our fill rate is. It has gotten better every single year. We have. What was that, Ms. Spider? Our vacancy count is down significantly from last year.
Ma'am, public comment's over. We're done.
We try to limit the back and forth. I'll hang around after the meeting. As far as personnel, with an individual, I'm answering your.
Ma'am, we don't comment on personnel matters. Public comment is over.
when it comes to specific personnel matters, we've never publicly, I mean, that's policy across every district in the state. Gary, I wanted to just quickly comment on the uncommon plans that you referenced. So you're getting that information, and I can understand this, from an application about 2 years ago. And we shared out at a board meeting, maybe it's like one of the handful that you may have not been able to attend. They're not building a school in Parkside. Their school is being built in Whitman Park. So it's not Parkside, it's Whitman Park. Get it that they're contiguous neighborhoods, but I just wanted to clarify that matter. And you know, you made the comparison as far as their ability to raise the $30 million for their school building, which I think is important given that they can utilize their per pupil funding to do that in a way that we can't. That's their flexibility. Students benefit from that new building. And at the same time, we're still working, as you know, and so this is an update for everyone who raised Camden High School. Mr. Francis, I'm thinking about you. With Camden High School, that commitment is moving forward. We recently met with the SDA again last week. They have hired a design architect. There's real money being spent. We don't believe this promise will be broken like the previous promises back beginning in 2007. So that is us fighting for capital for our schools in the same way that Uncommon is able to finance and build a new building. Mr. Waters, so just a couple things here. You mentioned Pine Point Middle School was graduating thousands of students successfully each year into high school. That certainly was the case a very long time ago. When I walked in the doors here, Pine Point Middle School had fewer than 200 students, and almost 100% of their students had IEPs, or they were bilingual, or both. And so that was not the definition of success. Pine Point Middle is certainly, when I walked in, it was not the school it once was. And so there were some real challenges there. As far as, am I questioning the signatures on a petition? No, I'm not scrutinizing every last petition, but signature on a petition. However, I attended numerous meetings and saw literally dozen upon dozens of families show up and talk about the safety concerns they have with their students having to travel to Woodrow Wilson or some other high school, and the fact that they want that school in their neighborhood. And so that is my job, to be responsive to those needs. And we can agree to disagree in terms of what's a need and what's a want. I appreciate that characterization. Ultimately, that's a subjective matter, and we can agree to disagree on that. You mentioned that we have an option of closing a charter school. I just want to remind everyone here, we have closed two charter schools since my appointment. There are two charter schools that have been closed, and they will continue to be scrutinized with a greater degree of scrutiny, if that makes any sense, than traditional district schools. I do think the bar should be held higher when we make those types of decisions for charter schools. They should be held to a higher standard. The money comes back to the extent those students enroll into district schools. The money always follows the student. I feel like I constantly have to remind everyone, less money on a per student basis goes to charter schools and Renaissance schools than the district schools. Our challenge has always been more about how we're investing those resources. I think what's important here is to be, Ms. Ortiz, I think what's important here is to be dispassionate about our assessment of situations like this. What I mean by that is, it's easy to hear one story about this student. Hold on, I listen to you, and I'm not going to shout over you.
Ma'am, you have to stop interrupting.
Our school information card will show attrition for every single school. I think it's important to look at the data and not solely rely upon anecdotal information. I don't I certainly trust what you're sharing with me, but I think we need to look at the hard data, because I hear from as many families that have that experience with district schools as I hear from charter families. We hear it from both sides, where a student is leaving Brim and going to another school, or leaving Creative Arts and going to another school. There's a lot of transitioning within our schools. It's a challenge that we've been dealing with for a very long time here. And so all I'm saying is to not jump to conclusions and say it's only Mastery, or it's only this school, or it's only that school. It's across all of our schools. Okay, last comment on this, and then I'm going to move on. I don't know if you saw the beginning of the presentation. We always highlight the positives of the district. We're creating promotional videos for every single one of our district schools to highlight the positive. Our school guidebook, again, shows the extracurricular activities and highlights the positive. We are doing all of those things as well. So I need to move on. I'll hang around after the meeting. Happy to talk to you some more. Mr. Brown, your comments about changing the grade level for an A. So currently it's 93 and above. Your proposal would be to move that down to 90, which is where most other school, if not every school district in the state. We've heard that from the student board members as well. We want to formally respond at the next board meeting. In principle, I would say that we agree. I just want to formalize that conversation internally, because there's some legwork in terms of recalculating GPAs, but it's a very good suggestion. We've been hearing it from our student board members as well, so we'll follow up. Ms. Shepherd, is she still around? So that was a pretty powerful testimony from her. This is her son that didn't make the Camden High basketball team. I'll just quickly say 70 boys tried out for 30 spots for the ninth grade JV and varsity teams. So we only have 30 spots. That's been the case. Coaches have to make those decisions. If I catch her, I'm going to let her know that there are some recreational teams that we want to put her son in contact with, so that we get him in a structured environment with some adults playing basketball. And this speaks more to mentorship than anything else. I was hoping maybe Minister Wasim or some other board members could reach out to this parent and see if there's just any support we can provide.
Absolutely. Yes.
Okay, great. Appreciate that. Mm-hmm. Completely agree with you, and we'd love your support here as well.
Well, I think they should also reach out to a gentleman who's sitting right there, Mr. Anthony Ways, who have Can Do Basketball right here, and she can see that.
That's actually
that
the organization
right
I had in mind. I didn't see Mr. Ways there.
Gotcha.
How you doing? Look, Ms. Carter, we disagree and agree on various issues. There's no deliberate attempt, and so I can't publicly comment further than I have in the past on this issue. I think we're going to agree to disagree on this one. Diversity is a really, really important issue, and one that we could talk about for hours. Ms. Carter, I'm gonna move on. Ms. Jocelyn. Is Ms. Jocelyn still here? So I appreciate you holding our feet to the fire on the ink issue. We followed up on the students' comments. The principals tell a slightly different story, so it's trying to figure out what's really happening in between. It's certain pockets of the building that sometimes don't see the ink or don't see the copies, and it's an internal communication matter as much as it is anything else. I owe you a better answer. I owe the students a better answer. We followed up, and again, what we hear from teachers and administrators doesn't always align to what we're hearing from students. But I think what the students are telling me is dead true. But sometimes in a big school like Woodrow Wilson, it's like one classroom isn't getting, for whatever reason, the resources that the next classroom is. So we've got to do a better job of that. And I that's happening on my watch. So we're going to follow up. We can do better. You mentioned MedEast. Yes, they won a grant. We wrote that grant. We advocated on behalf of MedEast. So yes, for bigger resource needs like that, it's not simply a matter of triaging. And so you're right about that, but I also wanted to give our team credit for having done that. No, I appreciate that. Yeah. Ms. Gooden, you mentioned the parent university as far as something that came out of FACE / communications, and it's something that's like your baby. I don't think about it that way, and maybe we need to just continue this conversation. I mean, that's like our baby. That's something we should work together on, the parent university. It exists. It's built out of the Kroc Center. I hope we can share in that and not think about it as like you versus us. As far as the parent meeting, I've spoken to Ms. Wilson about this in much detail. We absolutely did not instruct community school coordinators to send parents away from that. There was a flyer that was sent out, and that was, so certainly there was no malintent there. We could have done a better job because the location changed at the last moment, and that's where we really had the biggest hang up. And that's on our team, and we'll do better next time, but there was no deliberate intent to keep families away from that meeting. And I hope you trust me when I say that. Mr. Howell, you talked about lack of a librarian at Woodrow Wilson High School. And so this is, again, a staffing decision. I've said this before in prior board meetings where our principals are telling us that they would rather have another classroom teacher than a librarian when it comes down to ultimately the ratio of staff to students. Like, that is a trade-off decision. And that, you know, given the research skills that our students need and the fact that we have computers in just about every single classroom in the district, there is an expectation that our teachers help infuse that knowledge in our students, and we don't just solely rely upon a librarian. And if there's a school community that really, really thinks that it makes more sense to have one fewer classroom teacher and have a librarian instead, happy to have that conversation. But this is what our principals are telling us the needs are at the school level, that they would rather keep the library open but without a full-time librarian so that they can have another classroom teacher. And so that kind of, you know, again, we continue that conversation. Ms. Ferrante, I think we need to follow up on the Cherry Hill matter. I had never heard Cherry Hill sending students to charter schools, so I know our team took some notes on that. Teacher Roundtable, the next meeting is coming up on the 21st. I will be there. Yes, I haven't been to every single meeting. I think that if the expectation is that I'm at every single public meeting and the meeting can't move on without me, that's not a lot of work will move forward in this school district. We have a lot of trust in our academics team. Our deputy superintendent, chief academic officer attend all of these meetings. It shouldn't always have to depend upon me being there, but I do make an effort to attend every single one. I'm gonna hang around after the meeting if folks have further questions. Thank you all for being here this evening. And we're gonna close out here.
Ms. Wilson wanted to talk and then Ms. Burrow.
All right, we have a couple of board members that would like to comment as well.
In reference, Mr. Hannaford, in reference to what Ms. Gooden has brought before you, my concern has been, because I can say to you, 1 week from our vacation for Christmas last year, you and I had a conversation. And I said to you at that time, I was concerned about the way I saw things going. Things that should be put in place, I'm not seeing it happen. So the concern that I have is this, is that if we have employees who are sitting in a position, community school coordinators, when you first came into this district, I talked to you about parental involvement and how important the community school coordinators are for our parents and our children so that the children don't fall through the cracks. They stay connected with the home and the teacher for the child. And what I have seen is that the community school coordinators have been removed from parental involvement, which you have literally moved parental involvement basically out of the district, other than the ones that I hear exactly what you're saying, those parents who come in with Mr. Brian Morton. And I don't have a problem with that or against, because they're doing what they're doing. My concern is this, is that if we have funding coming into this district for Title I, II, and III, and I can see every month I can look on the agenda and there's always something there under FACE, Family and Community Engagement. I asked the state about it, and the state said Family and Community Engagement is something that someone who obviously came into the district put that in place. Because under parental involvement, family and community engagement, that was all one before you came. Then we found that the accounts, which is what our biggest concern is that the funding goes in each one of the schools for community engagement and family involvement for the children. The money sits because it's not being dealt with properly. And so therefore, the state and federal can look at it and say, we don't need the money, and that's not the case. And if you look at me sometimes and I look like I'm really thrown off, it's because I have that concern. I know we have seen it. We know that New York has lost their funding. We cannot afford that here in the city. So all I'm saying to you is this, is if our community school coordinators can work with our parents 3 days out of a year, where a community school coordinator brings at least 2 parents from each school, if we had 22 schools, that's 66 signatures, which can verify that we're doing what we're supposed to in those areas, whether it's bilingual, the DPAC, or parent training. The DPAC is on the district level. The PAC is in the school. The money goes into those schools, and we should have 2 parents at each school sitting with each principal when they have their monthly meeting, and they're working along with the staff to say, this is how we want that money to be spent. And if we're not getting that done, that can come back to bite us. And I'm not trying to see that happen, because what begins to happen after that? That's when we had to take the district to court once before. That's not what we want to see happen. We're working with Ms. Robinson. We've asked for a letter to be sent to the principals to work with us. If the coordinators can bring the parents, we'll come back and pick them up. But that training has to take place to justify those funds coming in the district. 3 days out of a month. And if we can get that, then we have the signatures, the training is taking place, and now I can get off your back with it. 3 days out of a month is all you have. And it's on the first year you came in when they didn't do the calendar. The information, the parents didn't know where anything was going on or if it had stopped. They literally have been told that it wasn't in existence anymore, and that's not true. Because we have to justify when we spend money out of Title I. And anything you buy out of Title I has to be identified that it was bought out of that money. That's why it was important last month's meeting, because every year you should have your business administrator and your person who's over curriculum to come and speak to the parents. Tell them what your curriculum is in your school. Tell them how they're spending the money for the Title I in each school. And if we don't do that, we can be written up through the audits, we can be written up through the federal government, and we can lose our dollars. Again, we need that. The technology and communications we had in this district, I can't tell you where the, we had district learning in every school, so our children could talk to anybody around the world. I can't tell you where it's at. Technology, there was computers given to the parents by Mr. Katz that was in the parent center. We don't know where they are, we can't track them. And if we can use those, then we can, because the parent center should be there on a daily basis for parents to come in. We know we have someone over on Benson Street, we have Isabel Miller. Okay, we understand that, but there are still things that should be taking place at the Parent Center, at Pine Point Trailers, for the public school, just like it is for everyone else. But we don't have the computers. They're being told they have to make appointments for a place which was home for the parents. So we need to be able to try to take care of that. And I do have, and I announced that normally in November and April, there's a parental involvement, district parent advisory council, family and community engagement on April and November. April 7th, or April's date, we have the president of the NAACP for the state of New Jersey is going to be our speaker. If I had that person come in for the meeting that we had this month, how embarrassed would we have been? Because it was less people than we have here. And that's something that we in the city of Camden was known for, was parental involvement throughout the state. And here we are. And I know that I've talked to everyone that I need to talk to. I've talked to superintendent, business administrator, and the issue is becoming a real problem for us, because I don't want to see parents go to the administrative law office and file a judgment against this again. Because they have every right to do that. So we need to be able to find a way to
Sir, please stop that. Interrupting.
Thank you.
Thank you for your feedback, Ms. Wilson. I think Ms. Burley wanted to say something.
Excuse me, we got Ms. Burley.
Ma'am, please stop interrupting. Miss Burley.
No.
This is a public meeting. This is not your turn to talk.
I can speak to you after the meeting.
Okay,
Miss Burley wants to say something, and then we'll hang around for those that want to continue talking. But we've got to bring this meeting to a close. Miss Burley.
I would just like to say good evening, and this board here is here to help everybody, but you got to be a little respectful for us too. But I just like to say, I don't know how often we update the computers in the schools to make sure these kids have updated computers. I know we need a library, but you can't tell me you can't get some ink in those schools. Three schools don't have any ink, and I think they should have it before weekend.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Point taken, Ms. Burley. Thank you.
Motion to come out of motion to adjourn the meeting.
Can we say
no, you gotta call for
Hold on, Ms. Blackshear wants to say one last thing.
On behalf of the Camden City Board of Education and the Camden Advisory Board, we would like to say happy holidays to all of you here in attendance and those who are out in the community. Have a happy, blessed holiday. Thank you.
Can I get a motion to adjourn?
Motion to adjourn.
Can I get a second? Ms. Regina?
I'm going to do roll call. Ms. Atwood? Yes. Mr. Jose Brito Bueno is absent. Ms. Dorothy Burley? Yes. Mr. Joshua Call? Minister Wasim Muhammad?
Yes.
Mrs. Martha Wilson?
Yes.
Ms. Catherine Blackshear?
Yes.
Meeting's adjourned.